Hey y'all, it's Ryan, and today I want to talk to you about how scientists can use applied physics to quantify brain activity. So an important component of cognitive health research, such as studies of stroke patients or those with Alzheimer's disease, is actually being able to quantify brain activity. And there are many different ways of doing this, but each has different trade-offs and provides different types of information. So for example, by looking at the activations of particular brain regions, we can identify which regions are involved in particular cognitive processes. But the trade-off is that by only looking at activation patterns, it is difficult to interpret how the activity of these individual regions is integrated with the activity of the rest of the brain. So figuring out the best way to study the brain is a massive endeavor that we're still trying to perfect. By quantifying brain activity, though, we can determine biomarkers for neurological diseases and trauma, look for individual differences in how people's brains work to determine the best course of treatment. For instance, the outcomes of music therapy in individual patients with disorders of consciousness can vary widely. A better understanding of people's brains' responses to music might be able to inform personalized therapeutic choices that would lead to a favorable outcome in all patients. And lastly, we can develop a metric to follow how therapeutic interventions actually impact the brain. One method of quantifying activity is to study the modularity or groupings of the brain's functional activity network.
So our brains are very complex organs made up of billions of interacting cells. And it's a bit overwhelming to imagine how we might be able to meaningfully study brain activity. So theoretical physicists like to uncover simple unifying laws to describe things in nature, but this is particularly difficult for something like the brain. We have this funny metaphor to describe the issue with overly simplifying complex phenomena. Right, imagine if we were interested in studying the behavior of a cow. We could model it as if it were a spherical cow, and that would make it very easy to understand because spheres are uncomplicated objects. But this sort of study wouldn't be useful in any real life sense. So one approach that strikes a balance between simplicity but still has holistic information is modularity. And this theoretical framework allows us to look at the whole brain at once and quantify the large-scale relationships among collections of cells. So modularity is the degree to which parts of the brain can be grouped into distinct function communities called modules. To measure this, we divide up the brain into regions, and we determine how these regions are functionally connected by looking at the patterns of their activity that's observed during neuroimaging. So for example, during functional magnetic resonance imaging, or fMRI. This gives us a network that describes how the brain regions interact with each other to perform different functions. The modules are then determined based on the groups of brain regions that share many network connections. And so the more isolated these modules are within the network, the higher the overall modularity is.
There are actually a lot of different measures that can be used to study networks. So you might ask, why modularity? Well, there's a really interesting theoretical grounding for the relationship between modular structure and function.
But modularity in general describes how the components of any complex system are grouped into modules. For example, let's say you wanted to make a strawberry smoothie. It would be really inefficient if you had to put your blender together from scratch every time you wanted to make one, right? Imagine all of the bits and pieces laid out, you'd have to solder together all the electronics, it'd be very time consuming. But fortunately, your blender is highly modular. There's the base module with all the electronics already in place, there's the module where you blend up your fruit, and then there's the module that you drink from. Right, so that's great, but what happens if you're having a party and everyone who's there, they want a different type of complex smoothie and you also want to blend up fresh dip and sauces, right? It's now you have a very complex task that you have to complete. Here, it's more efficient to have a blender with lower modularity, right? Where there's some crosstalk between the modules, such as being able to use the blending module to drink from, and being able to swap out different tops and blades as needed. Right, so as you can see, higher modularity is more beneficial at shorter timescales for completing simple tasks, whereas lower modularity is more advantageous over longer timescales for completing more complex tasks.
This quantifier is useful for more than simply studying brain activity. It can be applied to other biological systems as well, such as cancer gene expression to study cancer aggressiveness and metastatic potential, and antibody recognition of the influenza virus to study effectiveness of the seasonal flu vaccine. We're currently using this modularity method in the BMed lab, in my graduate lab, to understand how creative music engagement during a 6-week class impacts brain activity and leads to changes in cognitive health, quality of life, and social and emotional well-being. So we'll tell you lots more about that project soon. All right, y'all, that's all for today. Thanks for stopping by, and please click like or subscribe for more videos like this.